Good afternoon, everyone. So, we have presented, I am going to present these slides, keeping in mind for the beginners of Android. So, you know, generally we want to put an Android to the non-phone segment. So, what are the challenges that we are involved with? So I will not go into the deep, I will just cover the, you know, the basic minimum step that you can customize the Android for the mobile screen. Okay. So I'll cover first Android migration to non-phone segment. Challenges, what are the challenges when we take the Android to the non-phone segment? Then the memory analysis, what are the Android components which takes the more memory, what are the Android components which takes the less memory, what are the Android components which we cannot remove at all. And then how we can customize top level. Let's say being a developer, or let's say being, you don't know anything about the Android source code. I just want to configure some directory, some make file, and I want to remove some of the components. So how we can do that, I'll show. Then the analysis chart. So we have done experiment on couple of use cases, and we came out with the results, how Android behaves with those use cases. I'll show the chart for the performance. Okay, fine. So, Android has started to solve the problems on the mobile, okay? Then eventually it is so rich, people liking it, and the way Android works, touch, feel, the Android framework is so portable that, okay, fine, some of them thought that, okay, I can move the Android to the non-phone segments. That is, they have easily moved to the TV, set-up box also. Now they are moving to the home appliance systems like microwave, washing machines, etc. Can I get on? So, in a way that Android is so portable, such way that it has easily moved to the non-phone segments. Now we can see the number of appliances which has the Android enabled in the market. Any appliances you launch with the Android, it will sell like anything. So one of the key challenges when we make a non-phone segment product, we need to include the bill of materials and all this stuff that we'll cover later. But yeah, there are some challenges that when we take the Android on the non-phone segment, and when we look at the price of that product. Let's say I'm making a iPhone, high-end tablet, I don't need to think about that. But let's say I'm targeting a mass public, where I want to launch a product with a low cost and a high performance, then really I need to think about the cost of materials. Okay, why Android? Why people choose Android? The very most important point is licensing policies. Android is bundled with the Apache license. You take it, it's up to you. You want to sell it, you want to open source it, it's up to you. That's one of the most important point. Then it's open source, anybody can take it, modify it, whatever you want to do it. Ecosystem, I can see, I mean, those are the Android lovers. There are millions or billions of developers who support the Android. So there are large number of ecosystems already there with the Android. So you launch a product, ecosystem is there to give applications to you. So that's one of the key advantages when you launch a product to the non-phone segments. Let's say you launch a product to the microwave, you launch a product to the washing machines. Number of developers can write an application for the washing machine or the microwave. So that's one of the key advantages of the Android. Documentation is available. The range of reference hardware platforms. There are number of platforms. Panda board, Beagle board, Nexus, and then the Samsung has, Ericsson has. There are number of platforms to support the Android easily. Also, one of the key component is it supports C and C++ platform as well. So most of the applications in the non-phone segment which runs on the C and C++, probably on assembly. Okay. Some of the non-phone segments only support C and C++, not the Java. So using the NDK, we can easily develop an application C and C++ and we can run on the Android. then yeah, Android has a very good development tool as well as the debugging tools. So no need to, you know, set up, no need to buy any extra hardware for that. We just need to connect the USB serial port, install the driver, and start debugging your application where you use loopholes and everything. So what are the challenges that will involve when we, you know, take this Android to the northbound segment? The very first challenge is the cost to performance ratio. Okay, when we talk about cost to performance ratios, the two things comes into the pictures. One is bills of materials. Again, in the bills of materials, we have the memory, we have the peripheral, we have the processor speed, we have the power consumptions, etc. Okay, performance. So we need to optimize the Android performance using the, you know, inbuilt hardware capabilities. It, whether it can be DSP, it can be, you know, hardware accelerated media, everything, SGX or graphics, everything. Okay. Then the boot time. So when you port the Android to the non-con segment, let's say you are porting the Android to the car infotainment segment, or let's say some home automations. What do you want? 1 second boot, 2 second boot, 3 second boot, maximum 10 seconds, not more than that. Okay. So that is one of the key factors that we need to consider when we port Android to the non-con segment. Then, again, when we talk about the non-con segment, every segment has the specific applications needs to be run. Let's say I'm developing a home automation system. Let's say I'm developing a medical healthcare device. I have my own application that I want to run on the Android, apart from the other Android applications. That means I want a minimum memory, okay, that needs to be available throughout my life cycle of the product. Okay, so consider a use case. I am developing a medical healthcare applications and my on-chip memory is 256 MB, but I want a 100 MB of memory to run my applications, my medical applications. That means I need to run the Android within 156 MB of memory. All the Android components should be running with the 156 MB of memory. And 100 MB should be free, must be free for my own applications. Okay. Then ready to package solutions. So this is one of the key advantages, I mean key things that we need to consider. There has to be a solution available, I just need to integrate. Because here the question is time to market. So early you enter to the market, early you get the price. So porting Android to the non-con segment like point of sale, home automations, navigations, then the e-book reader, car information systems, everything has one challenge that is called as a memory. I mean, why I'm considering the memory? So let's say you consider the performance, you increase the performance, you increase the memory size, you increase the performance and the power consumptions, memory size will be increased and the memory cost will be increased. You want a high power efficiency and you want the low cost bills of material. When you are making a product, you want the total bills of, I mean, total, I can say, the total cost of product should be minimal. So one of the key components is memory. Because you don't want to compromise on the power front.
Just a question.
Yeah.
What's the cost of the memory relative to the cost of the product? Percentage.
It depends on the speed. When we consider, let's say, it is available $8 to $12 to $25 to $99.
No, as a percentage of the product cost.
Again, it depends on what you want to include in the product, right? There are number of peripherals available in the product.
No, we have a representative number for a particular thing, like 10%, 15%.
As such, yeah, I don't know.
That makes the audience relate to what you are saying.
No, generally, like if you see, there are multiple range of memories available. Like you have MDDR, DDR2, DDR3. So if you are going for a power efficient device, like if you are putting a tablet in space, then you need a power efficient device. So you will go for MDDR or low power DDR. If you are putting like a home automation server or something, then you want like more memory. Like there you will consider DDR3 kind of thing because you might have hooked to the socket always. So therefore, like we are seeing somewhere like if you want to buy like 10k units of memory of say DDR2 of 256 megabytes, if you go quote for Hynix and Micron or something, you quote somewhere around $15. Okay, $14 to $15. Now if you are making a product of just say $50, imagine like we have processor which is like $5 today, Cortex-A8 and ARM Cortex-A8 running at 720 MHz with inbuilt 3D graphics accelerator and all those things. So the cost of the processor is $5, but if you have to put a 256 megabytes of memory, for memory you have to pay like $12 to $15 if you want to go for DDR2 256 megabytes. Same thing if you go with DDR3, then you will achieve like $4 or $5. But if you want to go with MDDR or low power DDR, again you will have to put like $10 to $12. So it depends on what memory technology you are choosing and what is the performance and power that you are expecting.
Okay, so yeah, the one of the key components when we're choosing a product on the basis of material is memory. So here we are representing how to customize that Android with respect to memory. So how to optimize the memory? It's a money burner, as Kasim has explained already. So before going into that, let's have a rough overview of Android software stack. I think it's all of you have seen this slide a couple of times. I'll just give a 10 second overview. We have kernel, hardware abstraction layers, libraries. This is a native library as well as the Java library is also included in that. Dalvik machines, application frameworks, and the applications. So kernel, we have the kernel. Kernel optimizer is a different thing. So how Android boots on the devices? So we have a ROM code. ROM code will execute small piece of code which called as a first level bootloader and we name as a xloader. Again, that first level code will execute the second stage of bootloader, which will initialize all your peripheral on the products. That is called the uboot. Then finally uboot will load kernel into the memory. Again, after kernel executes, it will transfer control to the Android layer. So this is how it looks like. So when you boot a device, your ROM code will be executed. It will find piece of code and particular address, let's say some 0x000 address in your memory. It will take that code that will be executed. It will load again the second level of bootloader, which will initialize all your peripherals of your devices. Okay, then it will transfer control to your kernel. Okay, so when we talk about the memory, so what are the memories that will include in the product? So there are two types of memories. One is boot time memory requirement and one is runtime memory requirement. The boot time memory requirement is the similar kind of your living area. You can't compromise with that, right? You need that much of memory. Nobody can share anything extra in that kind of memory. So we have a NAND, Cedar Flash, where all your X loader, U-boot, kernel image, your Android image will reside in. Okay, so when you boot some, it will take from that locations and it will load it into the RAM. RAM is nothing but your play area. You go outside, you play whatever you want to do. So that is your play area and it is considered as a RAM. Okay. So these are the two memory parts that we need to concentrate. We need to optimize in boot time memory, also runtime memory. Okay, living area as well as play area. We need to also optimize our living area as well as where you want to play our Android software sets, that also we want to optimize. So as for the study available at this link, all the Android phones that exist in the world today, it's required minimum of 190 MB of memory with the resolutions higher than the QVGA and the Android version is 2.1 or later. So 190 MB is the minimum memory at present. Okay, so no device exists with the less than of 190 MB of memory at present in the phone segment. So these are the two use cases that we have concentrated. One is boot the Android with the 120 MB of memory. The second is, there is a use case, I have 256 MB of memory, but in that 256 I want to use around 100 or 130 MB of memory for my own applications. That means Android should boot with the rest of the memory requirements. Okay, so what happens when Android boots? When Android boots, it will see list of the list of the packages installed and list of the services installed. But depending on our configurations, it will keep on creating the services. Okay, and there are priority also set in the Android software stack layers. Okay, so Android phone. Let's say there is a application called as a phone. Phone and the call and SMS, email, MMS, everything. The phone has the highest priority, which will be filled at the list. Okay. So all the application you kill, last you can kill the phone daemon. Okay. But I don't want phone applications to be exist when I move to non-core segment. That means I should remove the phone itself, the call itself, MMS itself, email itself out of the Android package so that it should not give the priority when Android is running. Okay. So this is where we can, you know, customize the Android package and we can save the memory. So before going into the memory customizations, we have taken the memory analysis. So we have used the server tool SMEM. SMEM is nothing but, you know, you can dump the full, when your Android is running, you can dump the full memory usage with this tool. You can see the graphs, whatever application takes, how much of memory, everything. DDMS also you can see, dump is stress. I'll just execute to, thank you. Okay, so I have connected my mobile using the IDB cable. So dump sys will give the full dump. If I say dump sys, it will give the full dump of all the applications, how much size that is allocated, how much size will be used by the dalvik process, how much heap is allocated, and I'll just cover what are the terminology, PSS, what is dalvik heap. I'll cover that memory terminology. So you can see there's a process called Android process.media. This is responsible to launch your all graphics. So if you go to gallery, all your images will be launched through this process, this daemon, Android.process.media. So this is 4K, allocated is 4K, again the free is 24 pages. This is a PSS, I'll just cover what is PSS. So when we talk about the memory, there are memory anatomy includes. One is PSS, RSS, USS. PSS is partition proportional size.
I'll just go to the slide.
Okay, proportional set size. So, I mean, are you aware of the shared libraries? Okay, so here, when one process is running, it will share some of the pages to the other process as a shared library, right? So when you run some command, memory command, and whatever you see in the PSS is that memory, what is shared by to the other process. So let's say I'm killing a process, that doesn't mean that that shared process will also be get killed because it is used by the some other applications. One more anatomy is USS, Unix Set Size. So whenever we run some memory analysis, USS will say this memory will be utilized by my application only. It will not be shared. It's a non-shared portion of the application. RSS, Resident Set Size. So this will give you a real picture of the RAM at a particular moment. So it will include all non-shared pages as well as shared pages. So we have taken RSS into account when we are calculating a memory for the Android runtime. Then the heap, if we might know whatever allocations we are doing, will go to heap. And the dalvik heap, dalvik heap will be utilized by the dalvik daemon. Okay, and the dalvik heap is copy on write functionality. It's something like that. When you launch one more application, dalvik class will be created. Okay. But unless we are writing something, it will not create one more page for that. It will always share that heap. Okay? So because there might be a case that you are launching applications, you are not doing anything. You are not writing anything in background. You do not want to be heap to be allocated extra. Okay? So in a way, it's optimized internally, the heap.
First, so a couple of questions related to the previous point that you raised, where you said that you're going to customize Android for various kinds of form factors, right? Okay. You're going to remove components and then you're kind of going to make it thin. First of all, is it once you do that, can it be called Android anymore? Because I think Android also has got a compliance kind of thing, because you also are linked to the App Store. You take any app, you want to install it, Android expects a basic set of API there.
Yeah.
So if you're going to cut off pieces, is it going to be called Android?
So again, when we say, first of all, when I choose the Android, I'll choose the Android for the rich UI experience. Okay, I can easily make an application. Let's say I am making a peripheral, I am making a device which does not have camera. That means that all the application which use the camera will not work on that. But it will not give any error on that.
Yeah, okay. Is that okay?
It depends on the product manufacturer. Let's say I am making a device to the washing machine, I don't want camera over there. Or let's say I am making a device for the washing machine which has inbuilt camera application works straight away over there.
So my point there was like, do you need Android there? You can just take the basic Linux kernel, put a bunch of couple of services there, and then you have the thing running there. What I'm saying is like, it's not Android anymore if you actually cut off that part.
No, first thing is like, I think I understood
the
question.
Here's the point, right? If you, for example, remove the email application, if you look at the CTS compliance, this thing, it will fail you. So that's what he said.
I understood what your question is. So there are, like, if you see the flow of the presentation itself, like, what we explained, like Android, taking Android from a phone and tablet space into non-phone and non-tablet space. As soon as you take Android out of, like, do we know like how many Android tablets and phones in the market today are really certified by Google, saying like they are Google certified? Like apart from Samsung, HTC, Sony Ericsson and these things, other like if you buy Chinese tablets and all, they are not Google certified.
And not buy those tablets.
Right. So that's what I'm saying. So they, when you take Android, Google doesn't certify. Like if I take Android UI and put it into a UI panel and put it on a home automation system, Google doesn't certify them. So Android market doesn't work on such devices. So you understood my point?
So the basic point here is like, you're just trying to make Android work on small devices, but the other aspects of Android like marketplace and so on are not valid.
So marketplace is automatically cut as soon as you take Android out of phone and tablet space to other things. That is one thing. Second question that you had is like, is Android compatible now? Like say for example, you download application separately and if you put on this system, will application run? Okay. So based on your need, definitely you can run compatibility test suit, it runs. And say for example, on this particular device, you don't have Wi-Fi and Bluetooth, you will see Wi-Fi and Bluetooth tests failing on those devices. So automatically your compatibility test suit, instead of becoming 100%, will become 90% or 95%. But it doesn't stop you from running Angry Birds, because Angry Birds doesn't rely on Wi-Fi Bluetooth. So you can still download Angry Birds and run on this, and you will still get all applications.
I want to download more levels of Angry Birds, I'll not be able to do that.
Yes. So something which is related to a particular thing will not run. So those things will definitely be there.
Sure.
But it is still called Android. So where we are taking Android into is like the software stack and the components that Android has and the application segment and application ecosystem that it has, all of those things are available on your product. But only thing is like it doesn't support Android market. And it is compatible to all applications.
Just to add to that, the Google certification is only to allow Google's closed source applications like Gmail, Market and all those things to run. So without Google certification also, it is still Android. But you are not allowed to use Google's closed source applications like Gmail, Android Market and things like that. That's not required for the embedded systems.
Yeah, so you can just remove it, right?
Yeah.
Then it's not called Android.
It is Android, but it's not Google certified and it doesn't have these.
It's not called Android.
No, that's not correct. There's a compatibility specification.
No, that's for Google's application to run. To license Google's
application. For you to say Android, you need to pass that.
Yeah. I can create a distribution on top of Linux kernel and then I can call it by any name.
No, this is both from Android to
Linux. Yeah, please continue. It's okay.
Okay. So one more point I want to add on top of these things. One of the key advantage of the Android solution is I can take directly, I can port on the reference designs. And for that, I no need to be a software expert. I can, you know, just buy the couple of application developers which exist in the world today, Android developers. I can pay something, I can make my application straight away. I no need to bother about the, you know, application layer or the framework layer, which framework I should choose or which application I should choose. Okay, so that will save the cost on the, you know, making the software stacks.
Like any new kind of phone, and when you guys are building OEMs, the builds come from directly from Google, or you just download the JIT source and you build on your own?
So we download the JIT source and we do by our own.
Everything on your own, all the drivers and kernel drivers.
Yeah,
nothing like Google is certifying the build itself.
So Google will give the source code for the couple of reference platforms.
After you build, you ask the compatibility test. for Google to actually make it.
Yeah. After building, we need software. So you take it off. Okay. So this is the analysis that we have done. So what is the minimum living area we need when we run the Android on the BeagleBone XM? We have run the Android on the BeagleBone XM, and what is the minimum memory that we need is 100 MB. So I have presented Explorer, you boot kernel image around 3.5 MB. Before boot and after boot, there are two things. So, before boot, I have certain kind of memory. When once the Android boots, it will, load all the preloaded classes. It will try to, install the applications, which will again have that some .exe files which require the space, which you cannot remove. So that will be increased, and that's what on the 100 MB. So minimum memory you need in terms of NAND or flash is 100 MB at present. Runtime memory. So when you say runtime, so now Android is already booted. Now I want to see what are the RAM allocated by the Android, what are the RAM that is utilized by Android. So the core Java libraries, which utilize the around 13 MB of memory, the core system libraries is nothing but your web core, WebKit engine, then the SGX component, then your SQLite, FreeType and other miscellaneous is 27 MB. Surface Flinger will occupy, it's again based on which kind of library you are using, but it will vary from 5 MB to maximum, it goes. But again, it will include the display surface, your launcher, your wallpaper, your status bar, everything. So these are the buffers, it will be allocated by the Surface Flinger. So when Android boots, it allocates 5 MB of memory. Again, it can increase depending on the applications, kind of application you are running. Also, the Dalvik machines will start from 1.5 MB to 16 MB. Again, the limit to the Dalvik chip, you can make it in your source code. You can say that I don't want any application to be run which requires more than 8 MB of Dalvik chip. You can configure that in the Dalvik system. Dalvik source code. SGX. SGX is required minimum of 8 MB. It goes up to the 40 MB. Again, it depends on the what kind of application use case you are running. Let's say you are running a gallery use case which has a number of icons. So each icon will create, will occupy, let's say 4x4, each icon is 100 by 100 pixels, so 100 by 100 into RGB into 2. So this kind of memory will require. So it will increase depending on your application use case.
Have you tried media encoding or decoding?
Media encoding, decoding, we have not tried. These are the key components that, let's say Android boots, these are the key components that exist in the Android boot. Okay, I want to try playing a media and what kind of memory it will utilize. Okay. And some of the cache memory it will be utilized. That will be 42 or 20 MB. Okay. So these are in terms of the component, and this analysis in terms of the particular process. When we say Zygote, it will require 16 MB, system server 34 MB. System UI is 19 MB, media server, launcher, phone, Bluetooth, media. So roughly around I can say that if I club Zygote, system server and the system UI, I will require 91.5 MB minimum memory to see my home screen when after Android boots. So that much memory I do require. Okay.
Why do you need a Bluetooth for your home screen?
Yeah, you can remove. I have not considered Bluetooth while accounting 91.5.
Okay.
So it will only include Zygote, system server, system UI and launcher. Okay. So now in terms of customization part. So how do you customize the Android memory footprint? So we'll talk about boot time memory footprint and the runtime memory footprint. So when I say boot time memory footprint, I need to remove some of the components, as I mentioned. Let's say I do not want contact, I do not want phone, I need to remove from my Android package. Okay. So we have prepared one XLS chips utility which helps you out. Okay, if I remove this component, how much memory I will save? Okay. So I have just taken one use case, let's say I do not want contact, phone and the sound decoder. So So I'll remove all these components. It will save me around 8 MB of memory. There is a boot time memory gain. So I can straight away go and delete this package. Okay, no need to worry about the source code failure or something like that. It will straight away work. Any questions on this? So this I have just taken the use case study for the HMI device.
So these are most like you are removing the applications but not the framework or middleware components.
Yes. So in the framework, what are the frameworks which suppose the contact, I am removing that. Contact engine, contact provider, that I am removing.
And you have done it and it works fine, right?
Yeah.
So would we be talking about memory optimization for phones also?
No.
Is that not part of the process?
So, I mean, as a beginner session, what I am covering is, I don't want to go into source code. So at the top level, how can I configure my Android package to gain the memory? Yeah, but most of this can be applied to phone as well. If you do not want phone without contact, you can build your package. Okay, runtime. So in the runtime, it's a bit simpler to, you know, customize your Android package. Just go to build target product generic.anchor file. Is it visible? Okay. So this is the file. So what are, this is a list of all the packages that will be part of Android build. So you know, you just delete one of the those packages which you do not want as a part of your product. So it will not build, it will save the boot time memory, as well it will not be launched at the runtime. One of the main process is running is phone. Okay, and as I told you that phone has the highest priority which will be killed at least. Okay, so if I do not want call facility, I'll just remove from my package which will not occupy any memory at the runtime, which is taking around 9 to 12 MB of memory at the runtime by doing nothing. So one more file is this one. So over here you can remove one of the components that you might not need. This is a framework components. Let's say if I do not need SQLite, if I do not need contacts, then the location provider, I can easily remove it from this.
If you want to break up, you want to add the package.
You need to rebuild your Android source. Also, one more area where you can optimize in terms of memory is removing your wallpaper colors. For the product, if you do not want wallpaper, you can easily remove. Why? Because in the Android, every transparent application or the window will blend with the wallpaper. So surface finger will create the extra buffer for that. So I can say roughly around 5 MB of memory will be required, including wallpaper image size plus blending. Okay. So every applications will, you know, allocate the 5 MB of memory at the runtime. So if you do not want wallpaper, let's say you want your customizations blank screen, okay, you can put it over there and you can remove the wallpaper from there. So that is also, you can do it, you can just open to this file systemserver.java and you can apply these two patches. This patches is already available online for people. The other optimizations is you can change the LCD density. So you know, if you make a high LCD density, it will occupy more memory. Reduce the LCD density, it will occupy less memory. Okay. And the icon size. We have the icon size for the every applications. When we launch the gallery applications, we have the icon size. That also we can configure. You know, let's say I have 100 by 100 icons, instead of 100 by 100, I can say 50 by 50 here. Okay. The third area of customization is every resource file you can configure for the core components. Okay. You have a taskbar. We have a Bluetooth, you know, logo. We have a launcher, home logo, right? So those are the, it's around more than 2 KB of all those files. So we can put the less files, less icon files, with a less DPI. I can say 100 DPI files, if I put it over there, it will optimize my memory at the runtime. So after doing that thing, we have to just build our Android, we need to put it in the product and it will work fine. So we have taken a couple of use cases. So we have customized the Android for 256 MB, 144, 128, 128 with these features, 144 with, you know, with removing these features, and 256 with removing these features. So I can say that 144 MB is providing the optimal solution for me after 256 MB. Even I have run the 128, Android with the 128 MB of memory, but it has the low UI experience, poor UI experience. But the 144 MB it works fine straight away.
Have you upstreamed these changes to Google?
No.
Are you planning to do that?
No.
So it's more like experimentation within your.
Yeah, it's just a customization for the non-phone segment. Google does not care about non-phone segment.
Yet,
yes.
So it's more like for your internal purposes that you're doing it, but you're not planning. So do you have any OEMs that says I'm interested in this segment, I want to take the source code and then.
Yes, we do have a customers which says, okay, I want an Android which should run with the 128 MB of memory. I want an Android which runs with the 150 of MB of memory.
Are these slides available anywhere?
Yes,
I didn't write down everything.
So I have a link. I have already created the wiki page. If you just search for the Android Gingerbread memory analysis for the non-com segment, you will land into the TI page. So over there, I have given the full use case descriptions plus patches. What are the patches that you can apply and you can build your own package.
Can you go back to the portal slide where you were talking about all the various memory utilities, where you are showing SMM, BDMS, and SMM?
Yeah. So when you run proc name info, cat /proc/name info, it will show you the current utilizations. So right now my total memory is 280 MB of memory. Out of that, only 3 MB is free in my phone.
What about RAM?
It's not the engines, I'll experiment in the bigger production.
I have a very product.
Okay.
So it doesn't require issue.
Okay.
So now how can you convince me that Android, you can go for Android rather than Linux?
what is the product? It depends on that.
Okay, I'm saying I don't want any UI side. I'm just emulating UI totally.
Okay.
So I'm using a. I just want washing machine, you consider. I don't want UI there.
Okay.
I'm just giving an example.
Okay.
So how can you convince me that you go with Android?
One second, ma'am. Before we take up this question, since you are leaving, so we have a hackers section set up for all boards and the complete Android source and tools. So I would request you all to utilize that. And if you have any questions related to what all things we are discussing here, you can visit us there as well. And then you can use live boards with all the tool sources that we have and try out all the issues that you are seeing. So we are here today and as well as full day tomorrow. So you can even bring your laptops and get the complete source code and tools and everything set up and work with a board and get Android running and get a full end-to-end experience of Android on any of these high-end devices, starting from Cortex-A to Cortex-A9 to graphics to multimedia to everything. Okay, just thought of putting that note. Sorry to interrupt.
Okay, so I'm not here to convince you. I mean, it's depends on your choice, okay? But
I
mean, why you should choose
anything over it.
I'm not saying anything also. I'm just talking like a normal user.
Yeah, see, generally the way we talk from TI side is like if you have a head-based system for today, like as you rightly pointed out, as of today, the way the Android is and the way the Android is going, so if you have any head-based system, which is like UI-based system, we always suggest like go to Android. Okay, and if there is no head-based system, like if you are building a routing device or a network panel or something like, not panel, I'll say like router or something like that which doesn't need a UI at all, then we generally recommend them go for traditional Linux and with all your, like say if I am building a Profibus network or EtherCAT network or something, I don't need any UI panel, so in that case you don't need it. And as we are discussing so far, right, like Android is nothing but the software components which are there available in open source already, like if I take OpenSSL or OpenGL or OpenMax or your any component like SQLite, anything you take, they are all available in open source and they are not invented today, they are there in the market for long time, and Android has just picked whichever is relevant for the current phone market and then have made it like a single distribution. So if you are interested in any of those components, then you would rather go with Android, or you can go with Qt, or you can go with Ubuntu or something. You can create your own distribution by picking what components you want. Like if I want just a just Linux plus a browser, I can directly go download Linux, put a windowing system on it, and then download WebKit and then put a browser. I can do that independently also. Or you want to rely on Android, you can rely on Android. Qt also come up with similar logic, you can go to Qt as well. So these are all just nothing but distribution option available for embedded developers. So today Android is suitable for picking into non-phone segments, but we don't know tomorrow if it will be in that shape, because today ginger ice cream sources are like 10 GB, earlier it was like 3 GB. So we don't know exactly like what all things they are integrating, whether they will be suitable for other markets or not, right? So those things we will have to explore. Some of our customers are taking Donut and Froyo and building their products because they are satisfied with the stack that is available there.
For example, I don't want my washing machine to be registered to Google services when I log in.
Say, give me your email ID or log in.
While I'm washing clothes, I want to play Angry Birds. So that's the only use case there.
I think this question can be interpreted in a way that at the kernel level, again, at the kernel which Android has, it is not submitted to the Linux community. So data doesn't accept, because for the reason that the way they had changed the power management, Linux community doesn't accept that.
This is all politics which we got.
Yeah, that's all politics. What I'm coming to is if I need a system where I need a better power battery management, I will still pick Android, wipe out everything else, still use Android kernel which is used out there with the subsystem what they have. I will get a better battery operating device. That's what my idea.
No, I will give you a practical example. Many of the OEMs like BMW and things like that, who have this HMI for the cars, they used to use WinC first, then they tried OpenMoko and MeeGo and stuff like that. Most of them are now moving to Android.
No,
because the time to market, like he told, time to market is very less. And now the HMIs are coming up with inbuilt, downloadable apps.
Yeah, I'm not.
The apps are coming. So if it's based on Android, many of these stock apps can be directly ported to these HMI, so you can, while you're driving the car, you can get an aggregate crash. right? So those kind of scenarios coming, and most of the cars are now sticking to Android.
There is another big challenge also for OEMs. Like say, for example, you have LG or.
They are not gonna advertise as an Android base. They don't have to, because only BMW. They are not gonna even give the credit to the creator. There will be only a BMW base, but it's running Android.
I was trying to answer his question where you don't need a UI. Still, whether you will try to pick Android kernel or any other subsystem.
Yeah, to answer Android. That, like say, if you are a product developer. What you have to do is like you have to build your software stack. Okay, so today you have to build your software stack either in Android or either in Linux. If you build on Android, then like the semiconductor vendors like TI, like Samsung, like all these guys will provide you ready Android on their devices. If you build your own, today you might be with TI, it might work. Tomorrow you want to move to a different SoC, then it is your responsibility to take all your software stack on other things. That is a big pain. So therefore you stick to some distribution which these semiconductor vendors are providing. Thereby you will get all the customization like power management, like your UI, everything together, which is kitted, packaged for you on that particular SoC. Right? So Android on, like you might have all the applications which are running on TI plus Android. Tomorrow you move to a Samsung SoC because it is cheap, maybe say. Then you have to, you don't have to build entire distribution. You will just move your app here to there. And you will make Samsung work for you on all the Android customization, power management, everything. Thank you.
Thank you.
Let's thank the Digital Service for coming here and talking to us.